Yes, welcome back. Hopefully you enjoyed your lunch, but are not going to fall asleep because we need more and more active audience, and you started to be very good in the morning, so I'm expecting you to continue with Twitter, with the hashtag Finnish Army Seminar, or with the microphones in here. So I hope we're having a very interesting and active afternoon. So we will go on and start and move towards education and training methods in the 2020s. And just like in the morning, we'll have three keynote speakers and then the panel discussion. And we'll have one speaker from Finland, one from the US, and one from the Netherlands. And the first speaker is a professor of educational psychology, Kirsti Lonka from University of Helsinki. Kirsti, welcome.
Good afternoon, Commander, Generals, ladies and gentlemen. Great honor to be here with very safe company, enjoying it. I have this playful title of my presentation, and I'm talking about the mindset of the new generation that many people call millennials or digital natives. And we've been following up in our growing mind and called Mind the Gap project, those kids who were born in 2000, who are now 18-year-olds, and looking at their interest, using of technologies, well-being, and so on. I'm not going to any great detail about this in 20 minutes, but maybe you get some kind of taste about how it looks like. I wrote a book. I'm not going in detail any teaching and learning methods. I'm sorry to disappoint you, but it would be like 2 hours. I wrote a book about the Finnish new national curriculum, which is quite interesting. We have 7 broad-based skills there. The kind of king of the all skills is thinking skills and learning to learn, because that's the major skill that we are needing. And then, of course, there are skills like ICT, working life and entrepreneurship, communication and cultural competences and things like that. And then something which interests, especially I've been spending a lot of time in Far East or Eastern Asia, phenomenon-based learning. And I think we are dealing with a phenomenon here, a very complex phenomenon, which is military training and different approaches to that. And so we are trying to bridge different subject matter topics, but we are not giving up subject matter teaching, but we are adding some projects that are more phenomenon-based in nature and forcing people to see these complex relations among different kinds of topics. And that includes also art, sports, home economy, music, and so on in our curriculum. So there you can maybe read more. Learning is not only about increasing knowledge or understanding or thinking, it's also participating in a community of practice. This is a community of practice. You very much share the same values, roles, norms, hierarchies, and things like that. But when somebody's, if you want to identify what is your community of practice, you would have these kinds of questions like, who is your role model? Who is your hero? What's your role? What's your identity? And what are your values? And then what we need to think, if somebody comes to be trained for 6 months or 1 year, how compatible are his or her values in relation to what they are supposed to be doing there? And it's not an easy question. How to turn a hippie into a soldier in 6 months, for instance. And also cultures. When I was young and still in 2010, we are training people like this, like the left side culture. Very much of the learning cultures of the youth is what we call Starbucks culture. I've been in Starbucks in Taipei, in South Africa, Beijing, everywhere, you have Wi-Fi and good coffee. And then there are lots of people working side by side, very focused, very, very well self-regulated. And that is a very different culture. And now I've seen from Finnish telly how even Finnish Army is changing the physical facilities and practices towards this kind of culture. From this kind of, we called it the lecture illusion. Like somebody may be a bit sleepy after lunch, and the illusion is that the things I've been telling you would somehow magically become part of your cognitive system, which doesn't actually happen. I'm a memory researcher, like you would remember 10% of what I'm saying, many jokes and something that is very much different from your own thinking. So we call this extended working memory system. It's not like about technology. It's not about whether it's face-to-face or virtual. It's about how intelligent activity is merging between people and their tools. For instance, if this PowerPoint thing wouldn't work, it would be a kind of cognitive amputation. And that's why learning researchers, we would very much like to talk about augmented intelligence, like in Finnish, tukiäly, instead of artificial intelligence. Because these kind of different systems, they either promote our intellectual activity or they kind of hinder it. So there are many social practices and knowledge practices that are typical of different generations. They have their own values and own ways of thinking. Like, I'm a digital immigrant, that's why I have this print here, not my iPad. And we like books and so on. But very much people externalize or outsource their intellectual functions to systems. And I've been 10 years in medical education, and there the problem is that people either over-rely on technologies or under-rely technologies. And of course, we need to learn how to deal in situation where no technology fit works, and you just have this map and a compass, and you are cut out of your intellectual networks. There is a way of getting linked to or high-level intelligent network that kind of extends you your intellectual functions to a higher system. Do you know how it's that's called? It's called marriage. So the problem is that are we becoming increasingly smart or increasingly stupid with technology? It depends. On the other hand, we are linked to the most brilliant NATO network, or then we are outsourcing all our cognitive functions and we don't even know our own name, not to mention phone numbers. This generation I'm talking about is actually what we are now having. We are actually running out of alphabet. It's already Swedish O. because I'm kind of Generation X, and my younger daughter was born 1991. She was like Generation Y, but that's my older daughter. But my younger daughter is already this kind of Generation Z or true digital native, I would say. Because when my older daughter was born, there were digital cameras, DVDs, and so on. She still remembers them. But the younger one doesn't remember the world without mobile phones and internet. It doesn't mean that they have some magical skills, but it means that their knowledge practices are different. And there is a lot of important things going on, like transgenerational learning. Like my daughter is teaching my father how to use Facebook. And actually, the young people said that, oh, I'm so sorry for old folks. I was like, why? They kind of don't exist because they are not online. that's their view. They're very much multitasking, listening to music, doing mathematics tasks, and chatting at the same time. Not at the same time, but kind of parallel. Reading from screen, gaming, chatting, social media, kind of over-relying, almost overly dependent on their mobile devices, constantly wanting to be online. It's like the terrible punishment to put the Wi-Fi off, for instance. And here, virtual encounters are as real for them as face-to-face in many cases. The brain reacts similar ways. We are doing also brain research with Professor Alho and from University of Helsinki, and we've been scanning their brains. For instance, those who multitask heavily, they may have hard times focusing their attention. But what is interesting, gaming is surprisingly good for your brain, reaction time and so on. And those kids that we've been looking at, 60% of them are kind of basic users when they were 12. We are now starting new cohorts, but that generation. Using social media somewhat, but they didn't have any very advanced skills. But then 25% already at the age of 12 were active gamers. And they had already quite advanced skills of using technologies. And those what we call creative collaborators who are actually creating something new with technology, they are quite rare. So many kids are like passive consumers of technology rather than active participants or active creators of something. And in many countries, armies are really interested in gamers because their reaction times for kind of cyber war is totally different than from those who are kind of basic users. So there is happening a radical change in learning environments, not because we just want to have something new, but because we are changing our knowledge practices, our social practices, and we are fusing virtual, face-to-face, and simulations. So this is Finnish, from ICT classes into social digital practices. And it's going like this, and our school system is going like this, and I don't know how fast Army is going, but we are really constantly shooting a moving object when we are doing research on this. That's why we need to be very agile with our research in order to keep up with this. If there is time, how much time do I have? This is a 2-minute video.
Yes, you have maybe 6 or 7 minutes.
Yeah. Well, maybe you can we can watch this video at some point. We can put it rolling during some pause, but the idea is actually to show that even in teacher education, changing teacher education is like moving a graveyard. There is always somebody's granny and you cannot change it. But I've been creating with my team these kind of new learning environments, like physical presence is different. And my specialty is how to activate large masses of students so that even if I have 400 students in my class, we are doing interactive things. So it's not only that you always need a small group. I learned that from medicine. And we are creating new kinds of knowledge practices. In Finnish education, doing things by hand is still very important. We are doing gaming. These are my PhD students running this kind of game where we are doing the different targets and doing different tasks and all kinds of Finnish innovations. But this is how, and making animations and things like that. So it's very much fusing, doing things with your hands and doing things with your mind and changing the ways where you train the teachers. Then we noticed that we had changed all this in teacher education, but I was still isolated in my office on the fourth floor and my research team was somewhere else. So we also gave up our offices and created new kinds of engaging working environment, as we call it. But the point is very much motivational. There are other people probably talking about flow experience, how important it is. So you need high challenge in order to have flow, but you also need to feel competent in order to meet that challenge. Otherwise, you just get anxious, absorbed totally in something, losing sense of time. This is something that promotes intellectual evolution. And it's many people report it as a part of daily normal routines. Like one lady who was in our workshop reporting floor experience when she was doing Excel files. Like, you can really be engaged in your work. It doesn't have to be a bungee jump or something very exotic, or battlefield. We also measure, these are 15 people in my workshop, we are looking at how high is the challenge and how competent they feel. And if both are very high, they would be here. These people are very engaged. These were, the challenge was too high in terms of the challenge. These were totally in apathy and one was sleeping. But in the mean was average was here, so that our green, our wall turned green. This is scary. Imagine if you're teaching and the wall would turn gray. So we are also monitoring their motivational states during learning. And also academic emotions, increasingly important. Interest, curiosity, confusion. According to our research, they are the best predictors of good learning outcomes. You need to be a bit confused in order to learn new things. Then if I come to how to make a hippie or a hipster into a soldier, we have some strengths. Finnish tendency is to go near water or something green. Our kids are not afraid of forest. Many of them love it. Finland is one of the greenest places in the world. We are built to have challenges. Like, flow experience is not possible if you don't have a challenge. Sitting too much is a great health hazard. And exercise also fosters your mental well-being. How to find all this in the army for these young people? This is what they are craving for. And then the other one, what motivates a young Finnish person? Purpose. You've been using that word here, purpose. A meaningful challenge. They can take challenges, but they must be meaningful. The time of sense of duty is over. People are not doing things because it's your duty. But extreme experience is in. That's what's your playground. Young people tolerate a lot, but if there is a good team, hyvä porukka, that is what they want. They even go lower to salary if the team is good and meaningful challenge. Sense of competence is important, because if they feel totally incompetent and weird, they just get anxious and they stop learning. Also in the army, they need to learn how to live with boredom. There are lots of things that they report that there are boring things. And also anxiety when the challenge is a bit too high, because in our measurements, always before flow experience, they report anxiety for a moment when they are struggling with a challenge that is bigger than they are. Also worry. But only with shared flow experiences, they can pay this, what we call the affective cost of learning. If the affective cost of learning becomes too high, they just disappear. If we want to win their loyalty, shared flow experience is something that the gamers often report. Gaming is not a lonely thing. Gamers have communities of practice. Something, a meaning that is bigger than me, like our nation, a shared goal, a noble challenge. Kaveria ei jätetä. Your friend is never supposed to be left behind. They already learned that and keep that kind of promise during their adolescence. When somebody has been passing out in a bar, they never learn him alone or her there, but take her with him, the others. A loyalty and good team. Those are the values we can build on. And I'm convinced that if the Finnish Army can provide all this for the young people, you're going to get excellent soldiers, both male and female, in the future. And this is my message. Thank you very much for your interest.
Thank you, Kirsti. We'll continue with you at the panel, so you can go and take your seat while the two other speakers are going to give their presentations. So next we'll get some examples from the US, and our next speaker is Dr. Keith R. Beurskens from US Army Training and Doctrine Command, TRADOC. Welcome.
Thank you. On behalf of the U.S. Army TRADOC and General Townsend, we're honored to be invited to present at the seminar. And what I've prepared for you is kind of a smorgasbord of things that we have going on in the U.S. Army that I hope will promote a number of questions and interest when we get into the question answer part of it. The TRADOC mission is obviously training and doctrine command. So we develop the concepts and the doctrine. We do the institutional training for our forces. We consist of over 2,400 different places that we conduct training across the globe. There are 37 separate branch and functional schools within TRADOC, and they're spread across 8 centers of excellence that align with our Army warfighting functions. So from a perspective of scale alone, we have both some advantages and some challenges as we look at our training and education missions. The Army University was established in 2015, and it was established as a way to further how we develop learning within the Army. It provides us a way to develop a synergy between training, education, and operational exercises. In the past, in many ways, these were considered to be different in tension or competition, and not things that were complementary or that built upon each other for a much greater effect than just one or the other. Our Army is a doctrines-based Army, but everything begins with concepts. And so the topic is the learner in the 2020s. We have actually developed an Army learning concept for training and education 2020 to 2040. I will tell you that I don't think we've accurately described 2040 in the document. At this point, I think it's pretty much unknowable, but I think we probably captured 2020 pretty well. Concepts then lead to strategies where we identify different action plans that we are going to use in order to try and prepare for that future that we've identified in our concepts. And so key strategies that were developed that I think are pertinent to this audience were an Army learning model that was derived from the Army learning concept, and then our human dimension strategy. And so what I'm going to present after this slide is a model that we've put together for Army learning that tries to capture many of the characteristics that are required then to be able to move forward on both fronts, learning and then how that interacts with the human dimension. So our Army learning model consists really of 3 major components. First, we've transitioned to adult learning theory. And so with adult learning theory, the idea is that we have to engage the learner. It has to be relevant to the learner. It has to be something that they feel like pragmatically they can leave the learning experience and then use. And it's very different. Just prior to this, you heard the change from a lecture paradigm to where we have the sage on the stage telling people what to think. We've transitioned away from that to the adult learning model, where the learner helps us understand what they need to learn or want to learn. Of course, we provide context for that. We've also then got the learning process, and for us that consists of the learner facilitator. We've moved away from a teacher or instructor because it's a co-learning process, and then the learning materials, and they can come in many forms. And then finally, we've got 3 fundamental learning environments, and those really align well with the topic in the seminar, in that there's an educational environment for learning, there's a training environment for learning, and then there are experiences, and those can be gained either through exercise or through actual experiences where you're engaged in combat or some other type of mission executing what you've been trained and prepared to do. What I'm going to do is go into a little depth on each one of those. Our adult learning theory, we really have two different models here. One of them is still a training model. So that is a performance-based approach to learning. And I think all of our armies are very familiar with that. It's how we develop those basic knowledge, skills, and abilities, those fundamentals, those building blocks that allow us to then develop into collective training and into larger exercises. The difference, though, again, is that we're doing more than just telling the soldier what to do or think. We have tied to it then an outcomes piece and a reason why to all of the training we're doing. So we're trying to tie it to a larger idea at the same time that they're developing that skill. This ties into our mission command philosophy, where at every level within our Army, we expect soldiers and leaders to exercise initiative within intent. And so as long as, even to the lowest soldier, they understand the intent of the operation, then they can exercise initiative within their authorities in order to help move that intent forward. And then we've got the experiential learning model, which is an adult model learning model that we use primarily in the institution for our educational courses. And it activates the learner through a concrete experience appealing to the affective domain. We have them talk to us about their experiences, so this makes it relevant and helps them begin to delve into the ideas. The things that they don't cover, the things they don't know, we now cover in a generalized new information. So it allows us to not torture the student with information they already know. It allows us to meet the student where they are and move them to where we need them to be based on the outcome we're trying to achieve. Then we have them practice, reflect on what they learned, and then they're ready to move forward. Our learners. I wanted to give you some demographic information on our learners because that's really where we have to meet them. So over 70,000 soldiers a year we train within the Army that are new. So we have a high turnover. After 4 years, about 80% of our new soldiers have left our force. And so there's a large turnover in our force, similar to, I think, many of your armies. Over 500,000 soldiers and other service members, we do joint training in some specialties, are taught at all different levels in the Army. Our officers, interestingly, they all have to have a bachelor's, but compared to our society, have a much higher percentage of advanced degrees then. Our soldiers all have a high school diploma, which is a higher percent than our normal population, but they suffer compared to the normal population when it comes to a bachelor's degree later on. We found this very interesting because one of the things we recruit on is a significant educational benefits package. So what we've done over the last couple of years is we've actually developed some enlisted-focused programs. This isn't just so they can get a degree or a credential. We've done this to create a synergy between what learning they can achieve through pursuing a degree or a credential in a trade of some kind, and how that then aligns with their military duties and specialties. So it's not go get any degree in the world you want. We've developed programs that align with what their core missions and specialties are in the Army. This has been going on for about 2 years now. It's been very, very popular with soldiers because they get two or three times the credit, if you will, for the learning they're doing for the Army. And we find it's an incentive for them to stay in versus them feeling they have to get out to pursue those benefits. Our learning facilitators, I mentioned that we're getting away from what we think is an instructor or teacher model. What we've done is we had disparate organizations in charge of how we prepared our facilitators. And so we've developed what we call now an end-to-end faculty development process. And it begins with a common understanding of learning theory. And then we provide some of the specific skills that are used by facilitators, both for training or in an educational setting. And then we also have a course for our content developers, our curriculum developers. And these are all based on ways to support this adult learning model. We've reinforced that with a faculty development and recognition program. In the military, we all love badges. We love things we can wear in our uniforms. One of the most coveted things that we would have on an enlisted soldier when they came to our unit was a drill instructor's badge. And if there was an NCO coming in with a drill instructor's badge, we all fought for them. Why? Because we knew they knew how to train, to standard, rigorous training. It was a visible sign of exceptional competence. That's what the goal is with the instructor recognition program. There are, in fact, three badges now that are worn similar to a drill instructor badge. Very, very difficult to get. It takes over 600 hours of instruction with independent evaluations in order to get a master's badge. So a very significant and rigorous program. And then we also have a continuing professional development program where we're partnering with colleges and universities and businesses so that we have exchange programs where we bring their experts in, we send our experts out, and we both learn from each other. Learning materials, I think you're familiar with a lot of these. We have staff rides, both on the ground and virtual. So we've put a lot of time now into virtual staff rides because not everyone can go out and walk the terrain and experience a past battle. Common scenarios were talked about this morning. What we've tried to do here is have a common theme, a thread, that allows us to calibrate the force. So it's not so much about the terrain or the scenario as it is trying to calibrate a force of 400,000. And so these common scenarios allow us to help people apply our doctrine uniformly across the scenario and at echelon. Large-scale combat operations is our renewed focus, as was discussed this morning. Our training aids, devices, simulators, and simulations. There was a lot of discussion on that. And we have increased the use of those. One of the things not discussed this morning, I think, is that simulations allow you to get reps. And if you want deep expertise, you need repetition. And so it's not just that there are cost savings, it's not just that it allows us to more quickly, perhaps, prepare for an exercise and meet those higher level collective operational goals, but individual soldiers can do reps. So we try to give them engaging, serious games and other ways that on their own time, they want to participate and compete and develop the reps that add to their competency and their readiness. And then publications that we publish for the body of knowledge. And then we also have a common curriculum. Again, it's a way to calibrate across our force. The curriculum is mostly focused on our doctrine and then how our staff operations work. Our learning environments, and in the center, you'll see that it's really about context. And so the environment is important when we look at the specific type of learning that's going on. We still have our resident experiences. They've been technology enabled with the classrooms and with simulations and command systems within the classroom. We have five different levels of distributed learning. The highest level is actually an interactive, where the solutions are not programmed necessarily. You work through trial and error, and depending on how you work your way through, you may come up with a different outcome. So it allows for innovation, for some of that complexity, and not always striving for the right answer, but striving for an answer that worked. We've got our live, as was discussed earlier today. Our combat training centers are where we try to make sure that our organizations are calibrated and ready to go into a mission. By the way, it was in the 80s and 90s rare for one of our forces to prevail over the Op 4, the world-class Op 4. They usually failed in many ways. That's where the learning occurred. It was not part of a leader's report card. They received after-action review comments, and they received recommendations for how to improve their formations. That transitioned as we got into a long war and began using that as a certification event that demonstrated you were ready to go into the operational area. And then finally, we've got our virtual and augmented reality that we've begun using. The augmented allows someone to not only train so that they can be on the piece of equipment and have a way to be guided through what they should do, but also then when they go out into their unit, they can continue to perform maintenance or do the different types of things that they need to do in a real world setting, not just training. And then the synthetic piece is where we're able to pull very sophisticated things together and replicate not only what exists, but what we think may exist, and really stretch the boundaries. That's where we can get to a lot of our multi-domain type of exercises we believe in the future, where we can stretch that boundary. Finally, this morning we talked a little bit more about continuous improvement also. We have a number of ways we do that. Our Center for Army Lessons Learned is at Fort Leavenworth. They collect observations, insights, and lessons identified throughout the world. So they send teams out to do that, as well as solicit information to be sent to them. That goes through a verification process, and once it's been validated as, in fact, a lesson for the Army to learn, it's published as a lesson learned. They also make other publications that collect a number of different lessons and put them into a context. So, for example, staff operations, they've got a booklet that supplements Doctrine. Our after-action reviews are intended to occur on the spot. What was supposed to happen? What happened? What can we do in order to perform better? Let's go out and do it again. It's a very simple idea. It's very difficult to do well. Within the institution, we have something called an accountable instruction system. And so after a cycle of instruction, we will do a post-instructional conference where we've collected information from the students and we've collected information from the facilitators and said, what could we do better? What was missing? What did the students say they needed to learn we did not address? We analyze that, then we make recommendations to the commander for changes to our programs of instruction, and we implement those changes. It's usually a one-year cycle, and so we believe that's fairly rapid for introducing change to our institutional programs. We have Army Experimentation and Capabilities Development, our new Futures Command, which is established. That's their responsibility. They do the high-level strategic warfighting exercises and help us identify what those materiel facilities, those types of solutions are that we believe we need in the future. And then we have a new organization with in Army University, which is our Institutional Research and Assessment Division, and their focus is on learning sciences research. And so they're the only organization in the Army where their sole focus now is on looking at the science of learning and how we then harvest new ideas and new procedures and apply them to how we learn within the Army. And then finally, I've got a number of future challenges for you to consider that we're wrestling with. We talked a little bit about modern and future learners. I don't think that we're as concerned with the idea of generations from learning. I think our concerns are more basic in that we know that learners need things to be tailored so that they can identify those things that they need to learn, and we don't put them through the frustration of causing them to have to relearn or do things that they already know. They want it to be accessible, they want it to be engaging, and they don't care what the technology is today, they care that we keep up with changes in technology so that they can continue to evolve also. Our biggest challenge with learning requirements is the sheer magnitude. And so if you think about in the 1990s for our Army, when our focus was exclusively high-intensity conflict, and then you look at how we've transitioned to full spectrum, and now we're at multi-domain, we are talking about an exponential amount of information, of learning, literally, that needs to be done in order for you to be able to deal with all of these challenges simultaneously. Remember, it's not a linear process. Multi-domain warfare is not linear. So you can be dealing with all of these domains and all of these different levels of war and operations up to war simultaneously somewhere on the planet. So it's a tremendous amount that we're trying to have our people learn. Technology, it changes very quickly, and it's not all interoperable. I think we all suffer from that. Learning access, we talk about cyber as one of the domains. Well, we have that same challenge when it comes to what we're teaching and the access that our soldiers have to that learning when it's not that face-to-face. So when it's distributive, when it's something that we're allowing them to access through the cyber world, then we have to make sure that we take safeguards, which then means it's hard to access, especially for our reserve force. And we've talked earlier today about the importance of the reserve force. And then finally, our infrastructure. We all have budgets, we all have resource constraints, and to continually retool our infrastructure to be able to keep up with technologies, not only in our weapon systems, but in how we deliver our learning is an expensive endeavor and competes with other types of resource requirements. That concludes what I had to present. I look forward to your questions during the discussion portion of this, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Beurskens, and so we'll continue with you also in a little while. But our third example, it comes from the Netherlands, and the project manager, Jan Vermeulen, from the Royal Netherlands Army, is our next speaker. Welcome.
So I'll try to keep you awake in the afternoon after the after lunch dip. I will tell you a little bit about my existence into the armed forces. It's 40 plus years, so I'm an old man, and I'm not belonging to one of the categories that were on the previous slide from the first presenter. Born in 55, so 63 years old. So that's I've seen a lot. I give you some pictures here of some programs I did. That are some operational programs, but also a lot of training programs. What's happening? Okay. This will be a bit of the content of my briefing. So I'll tell you a little bit about myself, what is my expertise, my experience, the view, and it is my personal view about training in the Netherlands Army. A little bit about what I did in UCAT, the Unpaid Combat Advanced Training Technology. It's a NATO program, and I will come to some conclusions and try to stay awake. But I told you, I'm more than 40 years in the armed forces, starting as a conscript some 40 years ago, and I was in the military police, something totally different than I do today. After that, I became a professional soldier for something like 10 years, and the last, let's say, 30 years, more or less, I was working as a civilian for the armed forces. Did a lot of simulation programs, but also some operational programs. Simulation programs like small arms trainer that we're using, and I will go in more depth in some slides further on. And I did some, of course, the C2C, what you call in Finland the Kasi system. I did it in the Netherlands, and also did some virtual training and virtual system trainings, and also some commander staff trainers. Also operational systems, and you see that they come quite close to the simulation world, like battlefield management system, but also logistic tracking and tracing, and also the UAV systems. UAVs that will give information to the, of course, to the operational world, but also information to the training world. We have to incorporate that. If you take a look how training is built up into the Netherlands, then we have the different, on the left side, the different training systems, like CTC, commander staff, and so on. And you also have the different levels on the right side of training. The individual training, the group training, where you learn to work as a group, and then you go on a platoon company, and so on. If you take a look to the small arms trainer, I maybe have to wear my glasses, then I see what I'm doing. We use that small arms trainer now for something like 25, 30 years, at least the first one we bought. And of course, a small arms trainer is, the first ideas was copying a normal live exercise that you do that you do for live firing. And that, of course, is also a simulation. Live exercising that we do with the targets in the field is just a type of simulation. It's a very bad simulation because it is targets always pop up at the same location, and soldiers normally do not pop up at the same location every time. So it is a very easy way of representation of the real world. Also quite a number of issues are involved in live firing. You have to travel, you have to you have to depend on the weather. Weather could be different from moment to moment. But also there's a safety issue involved, and it means that learning becomes quite difficult if you have so many different variants that can influence the training, that it is very difficult to establish a certain training value of your soldiers. Most important is that you, in a small arms trainer, you can create an environment that is controllable. And the only focus you have to do, of the only focus that the soldiers need to have, is focus on the things you have to learn. And they have not take into account things like weather, waiting, rain, cold, hot, hungry, whatever can be set their mind into a different perspective. So that is one of the big benefits of when you do that into a controlled environment. Of course, that training can never replace the real world. So you always have to, after the training in a simulator, you have to go into the real world, and into the real world you have to prove. To have that excitement of firing a live shot, to have the smell of gunpowder and things like that. So you have that experience, but it's only an experience. Before that, you can learn all the tricks to be able to fire the bullet at the right moment in the right direction and aiming at the way it should be. So that means that you have to train in a simulation environment and prove your skills into a live environment. Now probably again it is with the wrong button. Probably at the end of the presentation I will do. A different type of training is the a system we have is the TACTIS. That's a tactical indoor simulation system, a virtual trainer. So you live into a virtual environment what can be controlled. And into that virtual environment, you We have mock-ups of a Leopard CV90, high-level mock-ups that you can do all the different things. So you can really do all your training into that virtual world. That's nice. It's very nice to see, but also very expensive. And at the moment you make a change, to your to your vehicle, you also have to implement that into your virtual environment, into your mock-up. And if you add a system from a different company, like you have a BMS system, you put that into your operational vehicles, you also have to put that into the virtual environment. And that could be an issue because it will cost a lot of money, and of course also it takes time. But you have to, because otherwise there is a difference between the real world and the simulation world, and you cannot train your people right. And into the tactical system, we have some high-level of high-fidelity mock-ups for the weapon systems, but also we have some low-fidelity mock-ups, let's say for anti-tank weapons or less important weapon systems. And altogether, you can do the training into that virtual environment. But of course, it's important is that training is okay. Yeah? We can do that with computer-added instruction, so that you can give all the soldiers the right type of training. But at the end, of course, it is the AAR, the after-action review, that is where you get the information. And soldiers, they have to learn that they're learning that they... That they see the result of their training. And if they don't see the result of their training, then they get lost. And that brings me to, let's say, a memory of my career. When I was a conscript 40 years ago, I had to go to execute into NATO exercises. Big NATO exercises, 10,000 of people doing, of soldiers doing with multinational doing exercise. And that exercise took something like 2 weeks. And during the whole exercise, and also still today, I had no clue what we were doing. I was just a role player, being exposed to the northern Germany areas, being outside, and had to go from A to B and from B to A and so on, and had no idea what was happening. And that of course is bad for our soldiers. If our soldiers are not understanding that they are part of the whole play, then it is very difficult for them to adapt to the real situation, what is expected from them. And that is what you can do with systems we have today, like a mobile combat training center. You can give them that experience. You can give them the experience from the highest level, so on battalion level or whatever level you like to train, up to the level of the soldier level. You can give them all the information and you can show them, or they can find themselves how their behavior was. And that of course is so important, because then suddenly this soldier is not a role player anymore, but he is part of the total exercise and he can understand what is happening. And of course, again, in this system that we brought from Saab in 2000, and Europe more or less did the same, and Norway did the same, and our three countries more or less did the same at the same, within a few years' time, and in the same moment. And by coincidence, this system is now is interoperable. But it's not just by coincidence, because Saab training systems built those three systems for our countries, and by coincidence we have the same software, or nearly the same software. And we're just interoperable to some extent because Saab allowed us to be interoperable. And that's a bit strange, because we are different nations, different armies, and we like to train together, to operate together and train together. And we do not never set a demand or requirement for having interoperable systems. We talk a lot about it, and you see also in the slides from NATO, interoperability is very important. That's it. There's no requirement from NATO, or there was no requirement from NATO, for that those systems need to be interoperable. And in the perfect world, it should be the case that all our simulators are interoperable. Even from the lowest level, if we have a small arms trainer, we should do that the same. Because at the end of the line, we all fire, we take a rifle, and we fire a bullet on a target. And that's the same in every country. So why could those simulators not be the same? And of course, it doesn't need to come from the same manufacturer, but at least we should set the same requirements. And that's a pity if that's not going to happen, because this will cost us a lot of money. And the more advanced we will get as armed forces, the more money it will cost, because it is all software. And the hardware, that's easier. That's just computers. It's not that difficult, except when you have the situation for. But especially the software, that will make the difference. This is a picture of my grandson. And of course, you wonder yourself why I put a picture of my grandson in here. But there's a story behind it. My grandson is now, unfortunately, I only have one grandchild. And luckily, it is a boy. Most of the time, that's the case with grandsons, that it is a boy. But you never know. But you see, my family is, my dad is died already 20 years ago. The dad of my wife is also died more than 40 years ago, because I never knew him. And I have our children. We have two daughters. My wife has a sister. She has three daughters. My brother has two daughters, and my sister don't have any children. And that means that at birthday, it's always only women. And that's terrible. All those women talking women thing. So when we got a grandson, that of course was the best thing that could happen to me. So I enjoyed it very much. And the nice thing is with the grandson, and he's now 5.5 years old. And he said, Grandpa, why don't you have a game? I said, how do you mean? Yeah, and a PlayStation that we can't do, whenever we can do gaming together. I said, yeah, but I never did any gaming, so. Yeah, but I will teach you. My grandson, 5.5 years old, is teaching me how to use a game. I said, we will see that. We'll see how. So I bought him a PlayStation and some controllers, and we sit together. Grandpa, yes, you have to do that. Grandpa, you have to go to that direction. Grandpa, you have to do that. I say, the son went to bed, and I was teaching myself, learning how to operate, because I like to win for him. But the next day, we did the game. And of course, what will happen? I lost. I could not even beat him. Because he's so quickly, 5.5 years old, with his small fingers, he's so quickly of controlling everything. And I was trying to, okay, what was it? Was it this button or was it that button? Too late. But it means that this generation is totally different in the way they are teach, they are developing themselves. They use PlayStations and they accept it for granted. And that will be our future. So our systems, and the biggest thing they need is that they don't say we like to have a direct feedback, but they expect direct feedback and not feedback half an hour later or whatever. Then they are in another world again. So keep that in mind. So important issues in training are trainers you fight and fighters you train as you've been trained. A realistic environment. And realistic, the training simulation environment has to respond in the same way as the real world is responding. If there is a difference, then people will get lost and they will not accept it. Immediate detailed feedback is an important issue, because with that feedback you will get the attention, and maybe even if you're thinking further, if you see in our defense organization, we decided that we give a smartphone to every soldier in our organization. Because we find it very difficult to reach our people by using the internet, giving them news about what's happening in the armed forces. And our we have a small army or defense organization, only 60,000 people. So, but still, we're buying 60,000 smartphones to communicate with them. And that's maybe something to keep in mind, that we can also use that those smartphones to communicate with them into the training. Give them maybe training results, using Twitter to give them live feedback about things that are happening. I don't know, that's something we should think about. Training in a simulation environment can be with imperfection, but will never replace the real thing, the real world. There's always an excitement. And I remember from the past when I did trials to that small arms trainer, that I see I have 2 minutes left. Okay. And I remember when we did the first trials with small arms training, that we had a number of simulators. So we trained people on the simulator, we trained people on let's say the traditional way, on a shooting range. And we had one of the soldiers that was trained on the simulator, and he went for the first time to the live firing, and he fired one shot, and he was so afraid about the weapon that he threw it away. Because it means the message is that you always have to be, so there's a different excitement, a different learning, that you get feedback from from a real weapon system, or an excitement that you get from a real weapon system that you cannot do in a simulation. And of course, you can simulate a lot of things, but the real thing is different. Interoperability. We have in NATO, we have a UCAT working group, and that UCAT working group was based together with Osmo, who's here as well, Osmo Forsten from your organization. Can I have a few more minutes? Okay. And we started, say 15 years, we started that. We were working in NATO, sitting in a working group, and we're discussing Land Operations 2020 and Urban Operations 2020. The view of NATO, how to get to the 2020 next year, how to get to that that time frame, and how will the NATO operations will be conducted? What will be the environment? Land operations, that means, and an urban operation means we go to an urban environment and a very complex world. So we started a working group, and the working group had as a task to make an requirements, interoperability requirements for that environment, and to train into the real world, so in the live environment. And that working group has now produced a laser standard. So we have in NATO, we have a laser standard, that laser standard will be able to be used into laser equipment, live training equipment, and we can all communicate, talking the same language. And that's a big step. And the next step will be that we do also all other interfaces that are into the, let's say, the CASI CTC world, that will be standardized. So there will be somewhere in time, as it continues, as it should continue, there will be a situation that we have interoperable systems. And then when we have interoperable systems on this level, then the next step could be that we go to the virtual and to the constructor field. But on this level, when we have that, then we have a basis of doing multinational exercises. And a multinational and an exercise only makes sense if you can give feedback to the users. And the users up from soldier level up to the level you like to train, as the general level or whatever the level is. And doing training, doing exercises, like we did NATO exercises 40 years ago, where I was just a person into a situation where I had no idea what was happening, that should be avoided. If you like to motivate people and give people also a position into the whole arena, then you should give them feedback of what's happening in the big picture. this is all already covered. This also covered more or less, yeah. Conclusion. Our gamers of today, you expect direct feedback. Trading system becomes and should become more and more interoperable. And the nice thing what we did in UK, that is not only initiative from NATO countries, but also from industry. So industry and NATO countries are working together, designing and developing the requirements, so that on one hand you have feasible requirements that can be built, and it will also take away, let's say, the situation that we that companies competing each other on this program. They can compete it, but on the same requirements, but not on different requirements. And as I say, the last conclusion is, I cannot beat my grandson. I think that will be no way that will happen to me. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Vermeulen. You can stay there, and Professor Lonka and Dr. Beurskens, welcome back in here. And we could start by checking out that is the audience here active and awake, and if you have a question or a comment, or you can ask a specific question of any of the panelists. So before we start discussing, maybe this would be a good time for you maybe to start there.
Okay, one question. We are now. Please wait a moment.
Yes.
For microphone.
Yeah, the microphone. Thank you. Thanks.
I don't think my voice is enough. So we are youth today are used to be online every time, and when we go to exercise, we cut them off. We collect the phones because of security issues. And how should we handle that in the future? How will that affect them? Because they are used to be online, but we need to sometime handle that in a good way.
A very good question.
That's been also an issue in schools and training in general. In France, they banned all mobile phones, and in Finland, the policy is different. Our goal is to help people to self-regulate and co-regulate the use of mobile devices and make it a meaningful thing. For instance, young people already make rules how they can reduce their dependence on mobile devices. And if it's a meaningful act based on safety and they understand its meaning rather than just collect away all the mobile phones, thinking when it's distracting, when it's a safety hazard or something like that, they have lots of strategies how they collaboratively regulate their own mobile phone use. And sometimes they're really happy when they are not allowed to use the mobile phones, because then they can focus on face-to-face communication.
I would ask that you consider that just because they want it doesn't mean they should have it. And I guess the point I'm making is this. To the extent that it would further our ability to be able to perform operations, I think we should put technology into the hands of soldiers. But just like at work, or just like at school, there are certain activities and things that either are or are not authorized, because it's called work, it's not called play or free time or entertainment time. And so I'm not trying to be old school about it, but I am trying to draw a distinction between wants, which we don't have a requirement to meet, and needs and requirements in order to have readiness and be able to perform our mission.
Yeah, you could also look at it from a different perspective, and maybe you should allow them to use those mobile phones in training. Operation is something different, but in training you could allow it. And then use the mobile phones to communicate with them, or give them a source of feedback. That could be, and they are smart enough that they, when they are in the training and they are not able to go to social media, that they can understand. And I think you should motivate them and let them understand how they, the best way of using those mobile devices. Because mobile devices are part of our world. And you could also, if you take a look at those things, those eye watches, they will give all kinds of information. So they can even give you feedback of how he is performing in his training. Is he settled? Is he happy? Or is he not feeling happy because his heartbeat is going up, his temperature is going up, that he doesn't feel too easy in his position. So it could also give you another information that could be valuable of how he's conducting the training.
I agree with what he just proposed. I agree with what he just proposed. And I believe that falls within the intent of what I was trying to communicate is there's a reason for that then. We're enabling learning, we're enabling communication and feedback during the training environment. And when we look at biofeedback and a number of the other man-machine interfaces that we're experimenting with for the operational force, then there will be technologies on the battlefield. The question, though, is to what extent do we have to allow soldiers access that they're used to from a perspective of social media. And there's obviously a security problem there that I think outweighs a desire.
More from the audience.
And there's one question on Twitter which is asking, do we challenge our soldiers enough? And there's the explanation for this question. So Generation X is planning how the Y generation will train soldiers of Generation Zulu. So all generation is giving planning for the training. What are your feelings and answers for that?
Yeah, I think that's there's some truth in that. Of course, we have a certain view on the world. But that doesn't mean if you are old in age that you're also old in your mentally old. So I think that's what our task is and what the task of any generation is to try to understand what motivates people and why people do things as the things they do. So I think that, yeah, but we have to be open-minded for that so that we can understand what their need is and how they feel come to the best result.
Kirsti?
I was thinking about the meaningful challenge, like we are role models for these young people. Are we challenging ourselves enough? Like, are we just giving up, that's not my cup of tea, I won't learn that? Or are we role models of being eager to learn new things all the time and taking new devices and applying new educational methods and developing our practices and taking critical feedback from anybody? That's a safety issue, actually. The most safest airlines are like Finnair with open cabin principle. The most dangerous are like Korean airlines where somebody who is subordinate cannot point out something to the higher in hierarchy. So I think it's also a safety issue to create a learning culture that learning is the thing. It's not teacher-centered, it's not learner-centered, but it's learning-centered. And the challenge has always is in relation to our competencies, and it's not like how competent I am, but what are my core competencies and where should I learn more? For instance, I feel that I learned from you here new ways of approaching competencies and things, and that kind of collaborative knowledge creation is the current idea of effective learning. So it's not about the level of the challenge, but the content of the challenge, context.
And continuing this Twitter, it says also that among young lieutenants and sergeants, there are a lot of new ideas and innovation. So how could we get that in the use? And Dr. Beurskens, you mentioned, for example, after-action reviews. Are you doing that already in the US?
Well, we use after-action reviews in a very focused way. And so if there's an exercise or a team training event, it's focused on what was the outcome we were trying to achieve, what actions did you take, expect to take, et cetera. I think when it comes to innovation from the bottom up, which I think is really what the question is, that's where I think, again, our idea of mission command and trusting subordinates that empowers them then to be able to bring ideas up, emergent knowledge, emergent ideas from the bottom up. We're not real good at that. So while it's doctrinally something we want to do, we're not very good at it. We live in a hierarchical, highly structured culture. And so it has to be demonstrated many, many, many times, and it has to be demonstrated even when the ideas aren't very good, that they will be considered. And it's hard for us to do in our culture. Mm.
You all talked about new learning environment and things that have to be changed. And there's a question, where is the limit learning only with VR and simulators versus repetitive training as soldiers? How would you see the combination?
Well, actually, my background is also medical education. So that we had this MIST in Karolinska Institute, this kind of MIST surgery simulator. And it appeared that a future surgeon needed to do like 70 trials so that the percentage of success was near 100%. Instead of operating your grandmother or 70 other patients, training this operation so that it was smooth. But then you go to the operation theater when there smells blood and there are guts and you have to open somebody's stomach, it's totally different. So the idea is that, and research is also showing that if you're too anxious, you don't learn. So it's better to learn the skills so that then you can integrate them, like not to be afraid of the gun or the patient or something like that, so you'd be desensitized to that. So it has to be very carefully understanding learning sciences and psychology and things like that in order to orchestrate. It's not either simulations or real world, but how to integrate them so that this optimizing the learning, accelerating the learning curve to maximize learning. Mm. So you need them in different situations. But I wouldn't like anybody to rehearse with my grandmother. Mm. I would rather let them have trials via simulators. Mm.
This is quite a big challenge. So what kind of changes in learning and teaching methods there has to be in the future?
If you take a look to how we conduct after-action reviews, the after-action review is the commander that is doing the after-action review with his unit. And that's a closed session. And it is, the idea is that they do evaluate each other. So that the after action review is taking place within the unit, not with outsiders. And of course the system will produce information that help you to do your self-evaluation, but the evaluation is within the unit. The unit has to learn from each other. And they know exactly what went wrong. And into a simulator, you can then play it again and see if you, to do it in a different way, have a different experience. And of course, virtual reality and things like that can help to give information, to give instruments to the user that they can trial and error. But at the moment, you say the simulator is to prove that you are having the skills. So you use it as a measuring tool, yeah, then the self-evaluation is gone. Then people will get afraid to make mistakes. And it is good to make mistakes, because then you know that the difference between a mistake and a right decision.
I would suggest that there's also, if we're talking about individual learning, that there is value in developing learning methodologies that allow us to tailor learning to the individual needs and to rely more heavily on self-learning and not so much structured learning. Because we spend a lot of time with groups of people where we're taking them all through the same steps, and we never know how many of them really need to go through all those steps. And so it's not only a demotivator for those people that are already competent, but it's also a waste of resources. And so I think that technology has gotten to us to a point where we can be highly tailorable, and we can have the learning experience exportable to where the learner can engage with it where and when they want. And then our responsibility is to verify competencies. And so it's a very different way to think about things. We're not compromising standards at all, but it's a very different way of thinking about individual learning. Now, our collective learning, obviously, we need teams to work together, to learn to work together, to understand the dynamics of their team. But I think we could make a lot of progress in the individual learning area.
That's very comes very close to the latest trends in medical education, and education is flipped learning. Cost effectiveness in simulation, like what we had was previously that there is one person who gives a 20 minutes lecture to those who are going to the simulator. And I was already then 15 years ago asking, can you have a CD like or something, like people could do it beforehand, and then you could, before they start simulation, you could test that they know all these things and then let them go. But also very much about simulations in medicine is about looking at videos about how they went. And actually simulation itself may be 10 minutes, but then the main learning experience is those 40 minutes when they go through the procedures and watch them on the video and see what was going wrong, so that people can have their failures and mistake as a learning material. And this kind of process is very important. So that's not waste of time of reflecting on learning and elaborating on learning, but telling people facts, lecturing for 8 people, that's not cost efficient. So we're trying to have the kind of reversed flipped learning concepts now.
Mm. And the next question is Professor Lonka. And also, you may also join to answer this question. And it's about the old method of the military training is like learning by doing, having 4 different phases. And the first thing is that the leader shows an example. The second one is that the topic is taught step by step. The third one is practicing the same thing step by step, and the last one is repeating performance as many times as possible. So the question is still this method valid in the future, and how could we improve this somehow? So, Professor, please.
It's a very different if you're learning, if it's cognitive or whether it's skills training. Because with skills training, you need like 50 hours of repetition before you are automatized it so that it comes from the spinal cord, so to say. So how to motivate people to do trial, and very often, again, we come that it's a meaningful context, like they are rescuing somebody and trying to rescue. It's kind of gamification, that you're constantly getting feedback, oh, now I'm losing this patient, I need to practice more. And kind of, especially these kind of skills training, there you can use a lot of technology as your help. And then vary the context, because it gets boring to do the same thing 100 times. But if you do the same maneuver in 100 different contexts, then you not only learn to do the skill, but you also need learn to transfer it to different kinds of contexts. So it's much more educational. And then boredom, in our research, anxiety and boredom are academic emotions that are suppressing learning. When people get bored, they stop usually learning, and their mind starts wandering and they want to go somewhere else. So curiosity and interest and engagement are those that we want to have.
I would also suggest that, again, we talk about people learning differently. Are we talking about the mechanisms they're using to learn, or that the actual process of learning is different? And those are very different discussions. I think that's talking about a process of learning. I see it, so I become familiar with it. I see what right looks like. Someone takes me through the steps in detail so I can understand how right was able to be performed. I practice those things so that I can develop the skills to do it right myself. You can do that through simulation. You can do that in the real world. You can do that procedure that I don't believe has really changed that much in the human condition through many new means, new ways of learning. But the learning itself, the process of learning, I'm not sure has changed as dramatically as sometimes we're led to believe.
Mm-hmm. Maybe I'd like to add something to that. If you see the transitional learning method, the four steps or whatever the number of steps is, that's one size fits all. But we are all different people. And it is, and of course, one size fits all means that some of the people have to suffer because they are smarter, they are better trained, or they have more information. So I think this both situations can help. The traditional training is okay, there's nothing wrong with that, but it is only for a certain percentage of the population. And other people need other training methods, or only need a part of that, let's say, traditional training.
And again, I think that's one of the great promises of technology, is because I think what you're saying is very true. Not everyone needs the same thing. It's not one size fits all, because we're able to tailor it. So while the learning process is fundamentally the same, I don't have to take as many steps, or I don't have to learn it in as many details as someone else, because I've already got some prior learning I can activate that's relevant. And so that, again, that's one of the great things, is we can have any combination of tailored learning because technology allows us to do that. It would not be possible without the technology that could help us sift through that data and be able to deliver what was needed.
Do you think an individual has to take more and more responsibility of his or her own learning?
There is this misconception, for instance, very typical now in Finland, that when we are talking about self-regulated learning, it would be that we would leave the learner without educational scaffolding, as we call it. So the idea is personalized learning doesn't mean that people are doing whatever they want and what happens to interest them and so on, but you need to scaffold the process that those who lack some self-regulatory skills, they need more support, and some people need less. And you have to withdraw the support gradually so that people become increasingly self-regulated. There are some misconceptions, like many people think that there are visual, auditive, kinesthetic learners, and that's not scientifically even true. It's an urban legend. There are lots of urban legends like that going on. There are even some people who design e-learning environments according to something like that. But there is this illusion that this message that I'm saying is the same for everybody, but it doesn't. They think this is now, this teacher-centered talking would be like efficient because it's the same message, but it's actually a different message for everybody. I don't know, somebody's thinking about their wife, somebody's thinking about the party in the evening, somebody's really doesn't have a clue what I'm talking about, and somebody's like, oh, it's so boring, I know all that already. So it's much easier to tailor with the use of technology and personalizing, tailoring it according to this learning cycle that we saw. So it's called the lecture illusion, that it's same lecture for everybody, but isn't. And we have now very good ways of diagnosing, finding out what people already know, testing their competencies, tailoring things, and also when they feel too anxious, we can see from our measurements if somebody's in anxiety channel, and we can, oh, now we need to boost her competence so that she has possibilities for having a flow experience. Everybody has flow experience in their own level. It's related to their competence.
Our time is flying, and it's time for a coffee break now, because it's only 30 minutes. So in order to get back by 2 o'clock, I let you now to have a little break and get coffee from the same place you got in the morning, right?
Yes, exactly.
Yes, just behind the corner. And I'll ask, thank you for the panelists and for your keynotes.